Welcome everybody here to day two of your coverage of Dreamhack Summer 2013. I am TobiWan, bringing you a live stream from joinDOTA. We are a secondary live stream. If you want to check out the other games that are going on, there are so many live streams out there right now. I believe there is a big hub of all the Twitch TV streams that are coming out from Dreamhack. The main official stream is twitch.tv/DreamhackDOTA, where you'll find the boys Bruno, Draskal, AC, as well as Too Good doing their thing over on the cameras there. But of course, if you want to stay with us throughout the day, we'll be here providing your English live streams for the BYOC team. So Keita Gaming were the first team to actually come through BYOC, and well, the other team to join them, Infernity. So we've actually got two pretty good teams. I was a little bit iffy about if we're gonna have ourselves some good games today, and then at the end of yesterday I was told what teams it was. I'm like, yeah, I'm down with this. I'm so down with this. It's gonna be a great time. So we're gonna start off with Keita versus Na'Vi, a game which normally you say, yeah, okay, well, Na'Vi, obviously clear favorites in this. But at the same time, Keita Gaming, they're one of those teams, they know how to topple the big boys. They come in with plans, they come in with big strats, and they are in a really, really rough group. As far as groupings go, they may as well have, well, they didn't draw the insanely, like, the worst draw. It could have been a hell of a lot worse for them. And I'm saying that in the nicest way possible. The worst group would actually be Group D. Looks like we're going to fail in our launch. Yay! So we're off to a good start this morning. Looks like I think we've got too many people in this game right now. So many commentators, as you can see. So yeah, no room. Well done. No room. So we might actually have to kick Ryan, unfortunately. Nah, Vlad's got three people in there. Kick him out. Yeah. So as far as our broadcast today, we're going to do Group C. So Group C consists of EG, Flipside, a team which you'll basically formerly known as Absolute Legends. They were known as Space. It was literally filling exactly what their team name was for a very short time. And they are now known as Flipside. The Danes, you'll know their team roster, obviously, when we get ourselves into their game. They'll be the last of Group C. Then you've got Na'Vi's in there. And then the last but not least is Keita Gaming. As far as Group D goes, now that is a rough group. If Infernity wanted a group to be part of, they probably would have preferred to be in there with Na'Vi and EG. Because in this group, you stand a better chance. Because a lot of people do value highly what EG is capable of doing at LAN events. They know there's a lot of experience in this roster. That EG, you can never count out the throw effect. You can definitely not count out the throw effect. There's been at least 332 games that they have thrown. It's just guaranteed, peoples. But at the LAN, they definitely have some better synergy together. But then again, a lot of people in the groups here really have a lot of synergy between each other. So I'm looking forward to seeing how Group C is going to end up. I think this will probably be the most unpredictable group as far as who will get through. So our last two games of this group stage are really going to tell a hell of a lot. How much Keita is capable of bringing down. And if they're able to get a win over Na'Vi in this game, the whole group goes into chaos then. Because then it is anybody's shizzle. And then Group D, Alliance, Fnatic, Quantic. All in the same group. I'm a huge fan of every single one of those teams. In fact, I'd love to see all those teams split up because I'd like to see all three of those teams in the quarterfinals, which will be coming up later on this evening. But not to be the case. But it's not to be the case in this because one of those teams must be eliminated. Only the top two teams get through. Results from yesterday. If you actually want to check them out, you can go over to joindota.com. We have a page set up there for all your information. So if you never found it, head yourself over here. Got a big, like, big Dreamhack button right up the top here. So you just click that one, and it'll take you to the coverage page. I've got this resized so I can fit it properly in, but you can do, yeah, your little rescaling and shizzle like that. But you'll be able to check out your groups right now. So as you can see yesterday, Liquid as well as Virtus Pro. They're the guys that went through with a clean sweep of games. Virtus Pro absolutely obliterated Team Dignitas. As far as their other games went, there's actually a good couple of fun games in the middle of all of that one. If you want to check those VODs out, we actually cast both of the two Virtus Pro games at the start, so up against Ubels as well as TCM. So if you want to check those out, youtube.com/joindota. And then for Group A, Liquid with Mouse, Lions Pride, and 4FC. 4FC, a little bit disappointing result from them. The Swedes the Swedish team 4FC has always been one of those like silent contenders that's been there, that's actually got like some good games up their sleeves. And yesterday, things just didn't really work for them. Lions Pride, really for me, the heroes of Dreamhack. I don't really care if anybody else wins or loses in this. Yeah, okay, now we're going to launch back in again. So I was just reading a very weird chat over on the side. But for me, Lions Pride, I don't care like who wins or who loses, because the games that Lions Pride gave us yesterday were just so great. They really put in the effort. Of course, they didn't come out on top of either Mousesports or Team Liquid, and that was a little bit disappointing for them. But really, they're... Lions Pride are one of those teams that we've got to keep a very, 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 very close eye on, especially now that Mini has joined up with them. He's a permanent stand-in right now, but definitely Lions Pride, guys, keep your eyes peeled for that one. And even now, I know I spoiled the result for yesterday if you did miss the VODs. I highly suggest you still watch that Mousesports up against Lions Pride game. Well, it's definitely worth the watch. The VODs over on our YouTube channel. But we're going to start off right now, so Na'Vi, they're in now the drafting seat. So we get to stop the recap of yesterday and get ourselves into the main event. And that's going to be Na'Vi, Dire side, because you'll know this roster through and through, led by Captain Puppy, Havorst, Dendi, Kuro, and Funnik. They are the lineup for Na'Vi. As far as Keita Gaming goes, Frigolite, Stevstar, Floxplox, CYSO, as well as Maglev, these guys are no mugs with Dota heroes. They play some really solid Dota. As far as like teams go, like, you always watch these teams, which you consider to be tier 2 teams, play up against the tier 1 teams, and you guys know what to expect, guys. You're just expecting, like, stupid mistakes, like jumping in at the wrong time, or buying a weird item, a weird hero pick, things like this that just doesn't make 100% of sense. And Keita Gaming is not one of those teams. They don't do that. They have a good, stable draft. They think it through. They get their timings right as far as their drafting is as well. So you look towards like the early, the mid, the late game. You've got the timings of their heroes, and they execute it really nicely. So Keita Gaming, I really think they've got what it takes to bring down Na'Vi, and we'll see if they're capable of doing so. We start off with our bands, so we take out the boys in green and the masters of trees, Nature's Prophet, as well as the Tree and Protector, being taken out by Frigolite, and he's happy to let the Batrider through for this. Puppy is very happy to actually take the Batrider then, but now, what does Frigolite want in return? The Darkseer was banned out, the Wisp was banned out. Does he want to go down the lines of a Lifestealer? I almost feel like he kind of needs to. He goes Visage and Clockwork.
Na'Vi's turn to pick.
So normal Keita heroes, just very early on, we see that Clockwork pickup, and Na'Vi go with what's stable, what's strong. They got no reason to risk anything here at Dreamhack. Dreamhack has always been that Achilles heel of Na'Vi. They've always had issues with Dreamhack. Be it they come to the event when their roster's really, like, it's not working, there's discontent in the roster, or their drafting's not quite right, they're off form, reason 532, yeah. There's always something that goes wrong when Na'Vi come to Dreamhack. Last Dreamhack they were there, they were eliminated in the, they were eliminated in the group stages for one of those Dreamhacks. They never even got through into the playoffs, but we'll see how they go. We'll see how they go today. They've only ever been to one Dreamhack final, and they ended up losing that one, too. That was to MTW, actually. So, Sindarin's old team. And, of course, Sindarin, he missed out in the last Dreamhack. MTW, his old team, in fact, I would say it disbanded, but there was a week before Dreamhack, and they said, okay, we're not coming. And then MTW, the organization itself, actually went under. And then you found out the reasons why it didn't happen. But now he's part of the Mousesports lineup. Sindarin, we'll see if he can claim himself a third Dreamhack title. Right now, he's on a decent way there, sitting in second position of group one. But we'll see how the quarterfinals will work out. Of course, make sure you stay tuned for that one later on this evening. Should be some really, really good fun. Lifestealer, so we ban out SD, ban out Queen of Pain up against Na'Vi. So they just take out an easy Dendi hero. Assuming the Funnik would be on that Batrider, or they'd run the Batrider in the jungle. And the SD as well. SD, normally actually a good counter up against the Batrider. Able to disrupt up the target, which is being lassoed, or the Batrider himself. Normally go for the target. That way, you might still get dragged, but you won't take any of the damage from it. And then, yeah, Queen of Pain. It could have been many different heroes. We could still see the puck come out. But more than likely, they're just worried about what's going to happen in that middle lane as far as who goes there. Like, you got the Clockwork, you got the Lifestealer, you got the Visage. So this is already Keita Gaming, or Keita Gaming, saying they want to run aggressive tri-lane. They want to go up against the Gyro and the Rubick. Keeper of the Light is the next one which really comes to mind. We were talking about it yesterday when I was casting with Clairvoyance, that you try and get that synergy between the Keeper of the Light as well as the Visage together, get that Illuminate out there, rack up the charges on the Soul Assumption, throw out the secondary nuke. Heroes like Rubick will just crumble under that kind of pressure, and Keita Gaming say no, they're going to go with the Crystal Maiden instead. The hero we saw a hell of a lot of last, and there's the puck pickup. Very, very obvious, very, very standard, nothing out of the ordinary here for Na'Vi. Keita Gaming, I like their lineup, but I'm interested to see if it can survive. Where the Crystal Maiden, Visage, and Lifestealer is still a very soft lane. Crystal Maiden doesn't get into position very fast. Visage is one of those guys that requires levels to do a hell of a lot. And Lifestealer going in close on a gyro. Like, Rage is going to help him out, but it's going to be the flat cannon damage, which is going to, going to slowly whittle away at him whenever he comes in close. And the Bane is the last band out. Obviously, definitely aggressive trial lane. Na'Vi, I would almost be tempted to just pick up the Chen. Tough it out with the Rubick and the Gyro in the early stages, then bring the Chen over and try and shut down. Ah, no, but then you're going up against Lifestealer. You don't want to grab yourself a jungle or hero when you're doing that kind of stuff. Which means they then have to fight on the lane. So the choice would be if they want to fight fully on, and that means like Lina and Lashrak pick up to combine up with a Rubick. Nick's Assassin has already been banned out by Puppy, so that option's not there for him anymore. And he could actually go with what I was talking about for Keita Gaming. Could always look at that Keeper of the Light to come his way. And Pugna, the final ban out by Puppy. So the last hero, which he thought might cause some issues for Puck. Because it is the mid-solo that's left. That bottom lane Clockwork up against Batrider, that's actually a decent lane for the Clockwork. While he's not going to have a great time for CS, and you're going to see definitely some high levels up in Flame Break, just to bounce it around, because you can't just Firefly yourself into a Clockwork. He's got cogs, he'll bounce you back. So Batrider has got to do it some other way, and that means Flame Break. That also screws around with Clockwork when he does put down the cog, can find himself on the wrong side of his own cogs. And now Frigate Leap. What's going to be that final pickup? Maybe that Pugna was 100% in the money for Keita Gaming. And they need to find something else to go up against the Puck. The OD's been... actually, the OD may not be a bad selection now when I think about it. Another little controller. Batrider wants to pull someone. Then you got that OD. Just go pull him out of time, space, and the continuum. And the other option I was thinking, which has actually left my brain right now, but OD was there and there was somebody else. Skywrath Mage. Skywrath Mage, another one, but he's going to be very careful coming in close on heroes like Gyro and Batrider. Initiation on them is going to be pretty brutal, but at the same time, Rubick, Puck, and Batrider would just melt to that Skywrath. And we'll see what Frigga Elite really wants to, and we're going to go with DK instead. So DK versus Puck, they go with their stay ability. It's a lot of life points. That's now some good Frost Dragon as well once he gets the levels up on that one. The team fight for Keita Gaming is actually quite decent. There's a lot of stability, there's some decent controls, there's some decent nukes, and there's also a decent way to split him up with that Clockwork. So it's really going to rely heavily on his initiation. And now Puppy is the final one. Notice the DK's in the middle lane. Another reason for that Bane to be banned out, that Enfeeble shutdown would have been very, very annoying to the DK. Hard to get last hits, have to use his brief fire most of the time. We'll see how Puck handles it. And okay. So my initial thought was actually right. And it is going to be Puppy's Chen coming up as the last one. They realize there's no massive playmakers in the early stage of that aggressive trial lane of Keita Gaming. So how do they deal with it? They run themselves a Chen. This also means if Puppy wants to, he can abandon his own jungle and just head straight down south. And see if he wants to go into the Radiant side jungle. Prepare. So let's look at our lanes. Everyone's going to head north to start with. I'm seeing smoke, I'm seeing sentry wards. He is not abandoning his jungle. This is Puppy looking just to get himself straight out there and get a kill. At the same time, Keita Gaming, they're doing exactly the same thing. Smoke up, move top. Let's run through the lines before they engage. So Maglev, Lifestealer, Stepstyle, Visage, Phlox, sitting there as the Clockwork Goblin. Put CYSO, then mid-solo as the DK, and then Frigga lead, the last Crystal Maiden support. Wards go down. They'll see a Vorse on the way down, but they've got to keep their distance with this smoke. They want to try and find the right line. They'll also get a little bit of a glimpse of everyone up on this top lane. With that aggressive Observer Ward, they got themselves in and straight back out again. They didn't want to fight a level 1 fight up against Na'Vi. Their level 1 is actually quite good with the nuke damage assault assumption. Their biggest problem will still be Rocket Barrage, but Kuro and Puppy, they got little to no damage in this early section. In fact, they are just, well, Puppy can level up a nuke, but that's not going to help him. He can't grab himself a creep after that then. It requires him to get actually 2 kills before he'll get that secondary level. Is Puppy actually going to do it? He could just be coming down here to drop down a sentry ward. The battle begins. But we're gonna see a split up now. So Phlox, man, I like that. I really I really like that from Phlox. And he keeps the block going. Want to just say how awesome that little maneuver was. Unfortunately, he just lost the range creep, but sometimes that's also intentional. You lose the range creep, and it means the pushing power actually stops. And you'll see just how far that held it back. Locking it in between the two buildings, and then forcing the creeps to go around that direction. And he still caught them up and blocked them off. It was nice. And that means that creep wave, it comes down a decent way. And that means he might get close enough to get some levels. And Keita Gaming, they're going to run defensive tri-lane. So Crystal Maiden and Stev style, levels will be the key. Stacking will also be a key right now. I have Lifesteal pop over here a little bit later. Let's want to look for these pull-throughs. A little bit of an early hit just there. Frostbiting up, because this is not going to stack now. In fact, he needs to attack the other creep, was this... Yeah. He's just trying to stop the Ursa. So not stacking, just farming with Frostbite. That could be a new one. It's going to be some good levels, however you look at it. Puppy already making his move on that top lane. The Ursa left the clap, but the cogs, it pushes him back. Puppy. Ah, there goes your Ursa's mana. He basically needs a new creep now. Could just sacrifice it if he wants to with the life points and a Vorse. You can see him already being as aggressive as he possibly can on Phloxbox. Just trying to force him back out of the lane. And then in towards the middle. Dendi. 3-3 up against a DK. 1-2. But DK is always a little bit slow with his CS in the early stages of the game. Gets that second point now up in Breathe Fire. But more importantly for him is getting that bottle up and running. Looks like he's already been like... He's running a stout shield so he can at least come in close to find these lances up against Dendi. But that's not where Dendi will get his power here in the middle lane. He gets his power from getting the orb timing right. But with CYSO, actually going on a slightly different build for the DK for the solo mid. Most DKs will still look towards the stump because he's waiting for like a smoke rotation or something like that. But that also gives us a bit of indication about what Frigolite as well as Visage want to do, which is Jackal. They don't want to get involved. If they get themselves involved, then they slow down their leveling. Steph Styles continuously pulling through. He's finding his levels. He wants his level 6 Phlox. He's going to get these cogs down right now. Puppy's coming in close. That Centaur right behind him. And Puppy, now for a second time, tries to get the first blood up here on the top lane. And will just stare down the clockwork. And this is okay for Keita. Gyro is still getting farmed, but Lifestealer is looking great in the bottom lane. Seeing it now 18 for 1, he started doing some damage to the tier 1 tower as well. This push from Na'Vi will bring down this tier 1 tower, however. Clockwork Goblin can't counter push this. He might look for a nice rocket to maybe slow him down. Actually, Na'Vi are running out of creeps. They got a couple of Chen Illusions, but they're actually running out of creeps. New sets on the way. But they had to just fall themselves into the tier 1, tier 2 tower gap. And there's the rockets, pull the creep aggro down, and that will go all the way down, back past that tower. This is making very difficult work for Na'Vi, and them even having this much trouble with a tier 1 tower, let alone pushing through to a tier 2 tower. This is going to be where this push ends. They take a very early tower, but now a Vorse has to come very, very deep to the Clockwork Goblin if he wants to try and find some farm. But then again, at the same time, Clockwork Goblin's also going to hang back because he knows how aggressive Puppy is being in this early stage of the game. Bottom movement now coming. Tier 1 town with a catapult. Testar not really with as many levels as I thought he'd pull out of the jungle, but then again, we are 4 minutes in. I'm seeing Crystal Maiden, who's also up at 3 3/4. Same level as a Visage. So it's that good experience coming the way of the Radiant side. And Maglev. Gonna pop up that salve, praying he doesn't get the aggro of the tower. Just keeps jumping around a little bit more. But they're gonna bring down this tower bit by bit. Na'Vi, they can rotate to try and stop this push, but... I don't know if it's going to be too late or not. It depends if Maglev can keep this catapult alive or... And he can't. The tower's looking pretty low. Oh, he's actually trying it. Keep that life leech going. He doesn't have the level 6 yet. They're giving him the sound so they can keep that catapult alive. It's too late. It took all that damage for nothing. And there goes the south. Fortification now going to pop as well. Puppy just throws out the nuke to cancel off the south. Try and keep that lifestealer as low as possible before he gets his level 6. And they give him another south now. That's 300 gold that's been put into consumables on this bottom lane. Just to keep that lifestealer up in life points. But he's got phase boost and orb of venom. This is going to be a very, very aggressive lifestealer if anybody comes into this lane. And Kuro and Puppy, they're the ones tasked with defending it. And because they're on the bottom lane, it means Phlox Phlox can come a little bit closer. Not too close, though. You don't want to aggro Havorst. Second you do that, he just goes all crazy on you. And with his phase boots, he'll follow you the entire way. Really good denies as well coming up from both Havorst as well as Dendi. Dendi sitting at 21 denies in that middle lane. Up against the DK, who's just had no farm whatsoever. This lane is completely lost for the DK. What he requires right now is a gank, a roam support. But Crystal Maiden, only to a short extent, can she find that level of control. Because you've only got that Frostbite. That's all it is that can hold Dendi there. Then the Dragon Tail is going to follow through. And the burst damage timing of the DK, well, it's going to be difficult. 6 minute rune's going to spawn, and Kuro sees it on the bottom. Might just babysit it for Dendi. The bottle is on the way out right now, so Dendi can heal himself up completely. And that's where you see Stepstar doing this. Sees the room, denies it off. Very, very nicely done. So the courier's going to have to take an empty bottle back to base. Just waste a little bit more time of the courier. Especially considering it's already... there goes the movement speed, but it's going to wear off in a moment. Lifestealer still having a great time on bottom lane. 45 for 4. Keeping up with the CS. It's just his other lanes which are getting nothing. Clockwork has 10 CS. Up against a 41 for 19. Of course, that is the long lane here, as you're expecting not to get that much. And in comparison to the other long lane hero, well, there was none. It was Funnick who's now down here, but he started off in the jungle, now with 40 CS to his name. And 1,200 gold. Starts with a Firefly too, so even with this creep wave pushing in, it's going to be difficult to take out the tower. A lot of extra stuff coming in. Oh, there we go. Finally, the kill on the top lane. First conversion. Clockwork going down to the rotation again from the Chem. While the tier 1 tower went down the bottom lane. And then what? Dendi able to get a kill on DK? Probably not really that surprising, with Dendi already up at level 6. The pressure of the poll is just too much for me. Sorry, Beatles. My apologies. We're now 7 minutes, almost 8 minutes in. And 2 kills in favor of Na'Vi. And the extra TP's on the way. So CYSO comes back to that middle lane. I would say it's kind of crazy that CYSO can go down to Dendi, but it's not really. And this is just because they haven't had that rotation to the middle lane. They don't have the proper ganking heroes that can actually capitalize on Dendi. But they can't kill off a Puck. He's very difficult to kill off anyway. Phlox Phlox. Still no level 6 up on him either. Try and snipe off a little bit here. Just throws it over the top. And sees the two supports are still up there on that top lane. Lifestealer getting closer and closer to Funnick, but Funnick also level 8 and with Lasso. Full level above Maglev. All he's got to do is just keep those napalm charges coming up. Maglev's got to be a lot more defensive about things. Clockwork still wants to get in close on Havorst. He just can't do it. This Clockwork pickup just did not work. They needed to actually run this as an aggressive try lane. To give Clockwork that space in the bottom lane. He just couldn't go up against both a Rubick as well as a Chen. There's too much burst. There's too much control. I'm waiting for this gank to come in middle lane, but I'm also wondering about this top lane. If they can get close enough to a Vorst, there's already that little bit of a surge up. Drum charge plus the phase boost. It's going to be a good call down from a Vorst. but he's already gone down. But then the fade ball in from Corroy. Telekinesis pickup. Who's he want? There's a pickup on Freely. Drags him back. Denny with a double kill. Orb over the top and the puck on the whole step style there. A triple kill for Dendy on the top lane. Bringing Na'Vi to 5-1. They do lose a Vorst, but it's more than worth it. And Fnatic also has to be a little bit more careful about this. Maglev is coming into that middle lane. But Fnatic, I think he's really considering a lasso up on CYSO, but not going to happen. And CYSO finally getting the lane he was searching for at the start. Gets that stick up and running. Already has the wand, in fact, now. Sakuri has come in. That's what he thought he was up against at the very, very start. Even though that would push a puck to an off lane, which wouldn't really be the way that Na'Vi would play that. Frigolite. Easy steal for CYSO. 2 points up in the Dragon Blood, so Dendy's damage. It's decent. But it's, yeah. It's not enough to get a solo kill out. That's a lot of support for Na'Vi now coming to middle lane. Blink in, and now Stev Style. A lot of trouble for him. Already being nuked on. Down Funnick. He's got a lasso over on the side. They get the kill out in the Visage, and there goes the Crystal Maiden. Actually thanking Koro. As the drag happened, and Koro actually stole Familiars as well. Out of everything that he could have stolen from Visage, he took his ultimate. And now they'll push out the middle lane. A tier 1 tower to go down. And they might even try and force more. And these Familiars, see just how effective they can be for Koro. Clockwork latches in. There's already Maglev in the middle of it, but a big fade bolt. Then the cooldown and the flat cannon. The life points just evaporate. And CYSO, troll trapped up, picked up with telekinesis. Puppy copying a lot of damage right there. The tower is, in fact, focusing him the entire fight, but they won't really care. Havor's got a double kill. Denny's got himself a double kill. They move over to Frigolite. And Fnatic right behind him. It's a triple kill again for Dendy. The second of Dreamhack. And this is game number one of Na'Vi, where they sit 12-2. 11 minutes, almost 12 minutes in. Guessing one stable works, huh? Radiant's middle tower has fallen. And the Vorst just bails. He's got enough for his time with the Dominator, but he's also got 2100 gold, so he might decide to go something else. Maglev, he can't help to kill off Dendy. You already all maximum range drawn out. Top tower is under attack. And now Keita. They've got to dig deep. They've realized now what happened on that top lane didn't work out. They try to dive in on top of a tier 1 tower into a cooldown. And then the TP supporting heroes just killed them off. They try to fight that one. And then middle lane. Small pickoffs. Big ulti stolen by Koro. All these little things just start coming together. Koro loves having friends. And T1 Town now in bottom lane for Na'Vi. I really doubt that anybody can try and stop this.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
So movement now to the T1 Tower in mid. Keita. All five heroes is the only way they can really feel to do it. All five heroes into the mid. Puck now with a day gone up on him. Looking for that burst damage, more than likely on a Stev style. Puppy in through the side. Maglev feels it coming. Fnatic though gets the lasso. Holding him there. Troll Trap drags him inside the pits. And now Maglev has to walk around. Also keeps him away from Puppy's creep so he can't infest. Now we can. Infest out Puppy. Soul Assumption will kill him off. But Dendy in through the rear. Visage the one who killed off the Chen. And Stev style locked in position. These trolls still working hard. The cogs pushing him back. But Dendy up on the high ground gives him another double kill. And looking over to Maglev. No infest. The troll trap's going again. Is there another one? No, they're both on cooldown. Couldn't stop his TP out in the middle of the rage. They needed that troll trap to do so. So it becomes a 1-for-3 trade in the middle in favor of Na'Vi. 12,000 experience, 14k worth of gold. That is their advantage. Leading the way. And to bottom lane, Maglev. Has to farm up in the corner. Get himself some more space. BT is now coming the way of Fnatic. Wonder if we'll see our awesome Mask of Madness build from yesterday up on the Batrider. Extra TP comes in, so Funnic ready to rock and rumble. Denny with his own DD rune. So a lot of damage already coming off from Na'Vi. Havor suspended most of his mana, but that's what Arcane Boots are for. And Dandy, what money is for is a level 2 Dagon. Rocket scouts out what's going on, but it's already too late. Roshan's going to be slain. And Avorst will pick up the Aegis of the Immortal. He bought a full BKB with his money as well. Looking very, very good for his farm. And Na'Vi now have the choice, and looks like their choice is bottom lane. Maglev already silenced up. Lasso. That didn't last long. Koro ended up stealing 4 points Rage at the end of that. They can look to push out their bottom lane. Is under attack. Familiars of the Radiant sign back up again. At the same time, remember too, we're like... Ooh. Keep their vision up. Dandy blinks up. So does Funnic. Both chasing CYSO. This time they're going to drop the ulti for it too. Flame Break is available. And that's going to cancel off his TP, and then a Dagon from Dandy. Just to kill secure. Goes through to 18. Bottom lane, mass TP's coming in. But then, call down by Avorst. It's just going to be one up the other. They TP in 3 heroes, but you know the delay is just going to be. Bada bing, bada boom, Frigolit in the corner. Avorst now with a double kill. Kuro, he will go down this fight, but Avorst, how much damage has he got in him? Not enough. He's going to lose his life right now. But he has Aegis of the Immortal and support coming down. Puppy's not close enough to pull him out just yet, but I don't think Avorst wants to leave. They want to go in. Blink Lasso holding Maglev there. And Avorst into the flat cannon. So Dendi with another kill now. 12-0-5. Dendi hasn't died once. And he's just rolling in the dough. Even takes out a tier 2 tower in the bottom lane. And buys a 3rd level Dagon now. And Avorst, I'm wondering if he just wants to finish this. He's pushing in on the tier 3 tower in the bottom lane, basically solo. Funnic's not willing to help him. Puppy still wants his money for his mech, which he'll now have after the next camp. And Dendi's on the hunt. Bottling up, still got one more charge up his sleeve. And we'll see Frigolit here in the middle lane. Orb, Rift, Dagon will kill off either Sev style or Frigolit. So there's your Rift, there's your Orb, there's your Dagon. Nice DK stun though, they can kill off Dandy, they do! DK kills him off, that's almost 1,000 gold for that kill. That's a big thing for CYSO to get. And this is something that Na'Vi, like, obviously Na'Vi are a long way ahead. There's very little chance that Keita can come back from this. But at the same time, you gotta take this into consideration that a DK, if he's able to find himself, even a half-decent farm to get to a BKB, and finds his higher levels to get into that splash damage, be it the Fire Dragon or be it more importantly the Frost Dragon, these fights can be very, very different. Especially when you got a Lifestealer. He needs his armor up and running ASAP. But he's also still very difficult to kill off. Because you've got that ability to rage and infest, but if you get that blink into Lasso like that, can't rage, can't infest, and he's so far away from the rest of his support up the middle lane. That's one of those things I was talking about where a tier 1 team plays a tier 2 team and the tier 2 team does things like that. I normally wouldn't expect that from Keita. I got a funny feeling it being early in the morning over in Sweden at Dreamhack with the pressure going up against Na'Vi at Dreamhack. And it's all just getting to them a little bit. This isn't the Keita I know. They're better than this. But Na'Vi will force out this tier 3 tower in the mid. Phlox still wants to jump in, but he doesn't want to do it without the Lifestealer. So now the attack onto the racks. There's still a fortification for the Radiant side. So there's your TP in. Clockwork latches into Koro. Koro picks him up and wants to throw him back out again, but not going to work. The cooldown. Ryan position. Flossboss actually being bumped out by the Flame Break. Hand of God. Koro, Soul Assumption will bring him down. But Avorst had all the time in the world to keep right clicking him to death. CYSO trying to TP out. Won't have time to do so. Stevstar being bounced around by Funnic, and he'll go down. Lifesteal to buy back, but it's already too late. And GG is the call. 19 minutes in. Na'Vi take a Rax, and they grab the GG, and they will go 1-0 here in the group stages. They will advance to the next game after a bit of a break. Their next game up against Flipside, so they go up against the Danes next. And then their last game of their group stage will be up against Evil Geniuses. Of course, our next game coming up on the live stream, I believe, is actually EG up against... No, no, what are we looking at? We're looking at Keita vs. EG. Yep, Keita vs. EG. Next game coming up. So stay tuned for that one, peoples. Welcome to the morning. We'll see how long the other game took. And give you an ETA on our next game. Remember though, Dreamhack LAN event. Which means delays are definitely going to be incoming. So stay tuned, people. Stay tuned. Hopefully you're going to enjoy your morning. I know Na'Vi are definitely going to feel confident. They're off to a very, very good start. So stay tuned. We'll be back here with more Dreamhack Group C action.
You got me dancing and crying, bro.